Boltzmann's law, right? And we also talked about the relationship between the intensity of emitted radiation versus the wavelength and the temperature, right? Remember the lecture day for yesterday, we were talking that as the temperature increases, say for example from 4000 Kelvin to 5000 to 6000, the wavelength of the maximum emission decreases, right? The wavelength of the maximum emission of radiation decreases as the temperature increases. That means they are inversely proportional to each other. That's what we discussed the day before yesterday, right? And today, we shall talk about the physics of scattering, absorption, and emission. Okay, physics of scattering, absorption, and emission. Is the screen clearly visible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good, good. Very good. So, the scattering and absorption lead to extinction of radiation, that you know, right? Because of the scattering and absorption by different particles present in the different layers of the atmosphere, as well as the gases and the clouds, the part of the radiation gets scattered, absorbed, right? And so that leads to the extinction of radiation. Okay. Now the diagram that you see here in the bottom right corner of the screen, it is illustrating a incident beam of radiation. It is illustrating an incident beam of radiation. Okay. Across a layer of the atmosphere, let's say this is a atmospheric layer having a infinitesimally small thickness, say, let's say dz. Okay, dz is the thickness of the atmospheric layer. Okay, and this is the beam of the radiation which is passing through this atmospheric layer. Okay, the intensity of the beam of the radiation, let us say, is I lambda. Okay. I lambda is the intensity of the beam, all right? And this is incident on this layer of the atmosphere, let's say at an angle theta, okay? Theta. And the thickness, okay, is dz of the atmospheric layer. As it passes through the layer of the atmosphere, part of it will get absorbed. And we said that, you know, absorption takes place because of the various aerosols that are present in the atmospheric layers. So part of this radiation beam will get absorbed, right? Part might get reflected, part might get scattered also, right? So the intensity of the radiation after it has passed through this layer of the atmosphere has decreased, right? And this is now I lambda minus dI lambda, okay? This is now decreased by I lambda minus dI lambda, okay? So the contribution is linearly proportional to the intensity of the radiation, that means contribution because of the scattering, absorption, etc. Is linearly proportional to the intensity of the radiation, number one. Number two, it is proportional to the local concentration of the gases and of particles, okay? And number three, it's proportional to the effectiveness of the absorbers or the scatterers, right? So they are the three things which determine how much the radiation will get extinct, okay? How much of the radiation will get extinct after passing a layer of the atmosphere, right? And there are, we just discussed, the proportional to number one, the intensity of the incident beam of radiation. Number two, how much is the concentration of gases in this layer? Okay. And number three, the effectiveness. How effective is the absorber, is the gas in absorbing and scattering? Because different gases or different particles are having different effectiveness, okay, for absorbing and scattering. Okay. Now let's consider a beam of the radiation passing through a layer of the atmosphere as we have discussed in this figure. Okay. So for each kind of gas molecule and particle that the beam encounters, its intensity is decreased by bi lambda is equal to minus I lambda k lambda n sigma ds. Okay. So this di lambda, as we discussed earlier in this diagram, this is the amount by which the radiation intensity is decreased. And this di lambda is equal to minus I lambda, which is the intensity of the incident radiation, k lambda n sigma ds, where n is the number of particles per unit volume in this layer of the atmosphere. N is the number of particles present per unit volume in this layer. Sigma is the aerial cross section of each particle. Okay. Sigma is the aerial cross section of each particle. Okay. K is the scattering or absorption efficiency. Okay. As we said, different particles or gases have different efficiencies for absorption and scattering. And ds is the differential path length, is the differential path length along the ray path. And this ds is equal to sec theta dz. Okay. This ds, the differential path length along the ray path, is equal to sec theta dz, where dz is the thickness of the layer and theta is the angle of incidence. All right. So this is how the extinction of radiation beam will take place as it will pass through a atmospheric layer. Right? Now, it is sometimes convenient to express the rate of scattering or absorption in the form di lambda, as we have said, is equal to I lambda rho r k lambda ds, instead of the other things like sigma, etc. in previous equation. We have replaced that by rho times r, okay, where rho is the density of the air, r is the mass of absorbing gas per unit mass of air, and k lambda is the mass absorption coefficient. Okay, so we generally try to represent, or it is more convenient to represent or express the change in the intensity of radiation or decrease in the intensity of radiation in this form, which is a function of the density, the mass of the absorption gas, and the absorption coefficient. Okay. Now, contributions of scattering and absorption to the extinction of the beam radiation is k lambda, that is, extinction is equal to x scattering plus the absorption, right? K lambda of the extinction, or extinction, is equal to the sum of the k lambda due to scattering and k lambda due to absorption. Okay, these are the contributions of scattering and absorption for the extinction of the beam of the radiation. Now, scattering by the air molecules and particles. All right, at any given time, a wide variety of particles of different shapes and sizes, as well as cloud droplets and ice crystals, may be present in the atmosphere, right? So for scattering by a spherical particle of radius r, the scattering absorption or extinction efficiency k lambda can be prescribed as chi is equal to 2 pi r divided by lambda. Chi is equal to 2 pi r divided by lambda. Okay, so this is the scattering by a spherical particle of radius r. So we are now making it proportional to the radius of the particle. That means the size of the particles also will influence how much of the radiation is scattered, right? Besides the scattering efficiency of that particle, and also it is dependent on the wavelength, right? It is dependent on the wavelength. Okay. Lambda. So chi is equal to 2 pi r divided by lambda, where r is the radius of the particle, lambda is the wavelength, okay, and pi you know already. So for the visible spectrum chi or x range from very less than 1 for air molecules to 1 for haze and smoke particles, and much greater than 1 for the raindrops. Okay. A particles for which x is much less than 1 are relatively ineffective at scattering medium. Okay. Particles for which x is much less than 1 are ineffective, relatively ineffective for scattering radiation. Now for Rayleigh scattering design, you must have heard about the Rayleigh scattering. Have you read about the Rayleigh scattering? Yes or no? Have you studied the, Yeah, Rayleigh scattering and the Mie scattering, you must have studied your BSc level, isn't it? So for Rayleigh scattering design, the scattering efficiency is proportional or inversely proportional to the fourth power of the wavelength. Okay. For the Rayleigh scattering design, the scattering efficiency K lambda is inversely proportional to the fourth power of the wavelength. That means smaller the wavelength, higher will be the scattering. Okay, for a smaller wavelength, the scattering will be highest. Okay. For my scattering design, for which x lies between 0.1 to 50. Okay. When the x is between 0.1 to 50, it is a my scattering design. Okay. Now, examples of Rayleigh scattering in the real life phenomena that you must be knowing that are, for example, the rainbow. You have seen the rainbow, right? Rainbow. Halo. Halo around the sun or the moon that you must have seen, right? These are the examples of the Rayleigh scattering, okay? The formation of rainbow, the halo are the live examples of the Rayleigh scattering, okay? For which the scattering efficiency is inversely proportional to the fourth power of the wavelength of the radiation. Okay. Now, you know why the sky looks blue, right? You already know that, isn't it? Why the sky looks blue? Somebody? Anybody?
So Rayleigh scattering.
Yeah, why it looks more blue? Because of the blue light is scattered maximum, isn't it? Blue light, the wavelength of the blue light is smaller, the smallest, as you can see in this spectrum. Now, which shows wavelength in nanometers in the x-axis, and the, on the y-axis, it shows the percentage scattering of the direct sunlight. This is a percentage of scattering of the direct sunlight on the y-axis. Now, you can see that from blue to red, the blue light has the smallest wavelength. And so the one which has got the smallest wavelength will be the scattered the most highest, right? So this is because of this Rayleigh scattering, right? And that's why the sky looks blue, because the blue light has the smallest wavelength, which is scattered the most, right? Now, these are some more examples of the scattering, okay? Say, and we said that the scattering also is proportional to the size of the particle, okay? So this is smaller size particle, this is slightly larger, this is much larger particle, okay? So it shows the angular distribution of the radiation, okay? This diagram illustrates the angular distribution of the radiation at visible wavelength scattered by spherical particles with radii 10 to the power minus 4 micron. The particles having radii 10 to the power minus 4 micron, having radii 0.1 micron, and having radius of about 1 micron, okay, or different sizes, okay. This is 10 to the power minus 4 micron, this is 0.1 micron, and this is 1 micron. So how the radiation will get scattered differently according to the radius or size of the particle. This is what is illustrated in this diagram. Okay. The forward scattering the forward scattering, okay, for 1 micron aerosol, like, you know, say, let's say this is the aerosol of having radius of 1 micron, the forward scattering is extremely large, okay. Forward scattering is extremely large for the aerosols having radius equal to 1 or greater than 1 micron. Okay. Now, in this diagram also, you know, different types of scattering is illustrated. Okay. Say relay scattering, Mai scattering. Okay. Now, if you look at from the overhead, the relay scattering is dominant. Okay. The Mai scattering intensity being projected forward. Okay. Since relay scattering strongly favors short wavelengths, we see the sky blue that we just discussed a few minutes earlier. Okay. So if there is an observer looking from here, okay, and for an observer, the forward lobe of the Mai scattering is dominant, okay, as in this figure. The forward lobe of the Mai scattering is dominant. Since it is not very wavelength dependent, we see a white glare around the sun. So, the glare around the sun that we see, the white glare, sometimes even the halo, is because of the Mai scattering. Okay. And this diagram illustrates the scattering because of the particles of different sizes at different wavelengths of different radius. For instance, on the x-axis, what you see here is the wavelength. Okay, wavelength shown in the x-axis in micrometer. Y-axis, so the radius of the particle, again in micron. And for various types of the particles which can be present in the atmosphere, like air molecules, okay, having very small radius, less than 10 power minus 3 micron, to smoke, dust, or haze having radius 10 power minus 1 micron, the cloud droplets having radius about 10 microns, drizzle, right, having radius of 10 power 2 microns, that is 100 microns, and raindrops, the largest size, right, the largest size among all is a raindrop, which can have the radius greater than 10 power 3. Micron, about 4 micron, right? I mean, radius of the droplets can be as large as 1 millimeter sometimes, right? 1 millimeter raindrops. But generally, more than that radius, no, the raindrops are not seen because they break down, okay? So, as you can see, now this is the wavelength, right? This is the wavelength. And this is the regime of the solar radiation because it's shorter wavelength, right? And this is for the longer wavelength. This is the terrestrial radiation, right? Radiation emitted by the Earth or by the particles present in the atmosphere, okay? Like the raindrops or aerosols, etc. Okay, so anything which is outgoing long wave radiation, right, from the Earth's surface is the terrestrial radiation, okay? And further longer wavelengths, like for the weather radars, they are the long wavelengths for weather radars, right? And as you can see that, now depending upon the size of the particle and the wavelength, the scattering can be negligible, or it will scatter in the relay scattering regime, or it will scatter in the Mai scattering regime, right? This is one, x is equal to 1, right? X is equal to 1. And we have seen that when x is much smaller than 1, what will happen? Okay, when x is much smaller than 1, we talked just now earlier that it will be in the relay scattering regime, like in this one, this on this side. And when x is between 0.1 to 50, then it will be the Mai scattering regime, right? So above this line is the Mai scattering, below this line is the relay scattering. Right? And further below, if you go, then it is negligible. The amount of scattering is negligible. Okay. Now, absorption by the particles. We can continue a little more, right? Because we started a little late, so we can go a little later. Is that okay to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So we will discuss about the absorption by particles. Okay. So as we discussed, when x is much greater than 1, okay, when x is much greater than 1, the extinction coefficient approaches 2. Okay. When x is approximately equal to 1, the scattering coefficient is approximately equal to 1, that means it will have the strongest absorption. Right? Absorption will be strong. And when the scattering coefficient is equal to 2, then the absorption will be negligible. Right? Absorption will be negligible. Right? So when radiation interacts with matter, it is absorbed, scattered, or emitted in discrete packets called photons. Right? When the radiation interacts with matter, it is either absorbed or scattered or emitted in discrete packets called photons. And each photon contains energy, okay, which is equal to h nu, right? Where h is the Planck's constant, which is equal to 6.626 times to the power minus 34 joules, right? And nu is the frequency. Now, absorption continua. What is absorption continua? Extreme ultraviolet radiation, its wavelength is less than 0.1 micron, emitted by sun's outer atmosphere, is sufficiently energetic to strip electrons from the atoms. And this is called the photoionization, right? Photoionization. You should remember these definitions, because sometimes in the examination, you will get small sort of questions that, what is photoionization, right? So photoionization is the stripping, okay, stripping of the electrons from the atoms because of the extreme ultraviolet radiation emitted by sun's outer atmosphere, okay, which is sufficiently energetic. The radiation in this wavelength range is absorbed in the ionosphere. Okay, and that's why, you know, we are safe, we are safely living on the earth. Had it not been absorbed maximum in the ionosphere, no, we couldn't have survived on the earth. So a large portion of the UV radiation is absorbed in the ionosphere, and the remaining are mostly absorbed in the ozonosphere. Okay, so the altitude of the ionosphere, as you know, is about 90 kilometers above the ground. And it gives rise to sufficient number of free electrons to affect the propagation of radio waves. So it also helps in propagation of the radio waves because of the presence of large amount of ions in the ionosphere. Now radiation at wavelength equal to 0.24 micron is sufficiently energetic to break oxygen molecules apart into oxygen atoms. And this process is referred to as photodissociation. It's called the photodissociation. Earlier we discussed about photoionization, and this is the photodissociation. Now, what is this photodissociation? It is the breaking of the oxygen molecules. The breaking of the oxygen molecules by radiation at wavelength 0.24 micron. Okay. The oxygen atoms liberated in this reaction are instrumental in the production of ozone, O3. Okay. So this is about the photoionization, photodissociation. Okay. Now, what are the absorption lines? Absorption lines. Okay. Now, radiation at visible and infrared wavelength does not possess sufficient energy to produce photoionization. Okay. Because that is produced by the UV, not by the visible or IR wavelengths. Okay, so they don't have sufficient energy. Radiation at visible and IR wavelengths do not have sufficient energy to produce photoionization or photodissociation. But under certain conditions, appreciable absorption can nonetheless occur. Okay, under certain conditions. At visible and longer wavelengths, Absorptivity is described in terms of a line spectrum consisting of extremely narrow absorption lines separated by much wider gaps in which the gas is virtually transparent to incident radiation. Okay. A few days ago, we were talking about the atmospheric window, etc. And that is what is atmospheric window, where it is virtually transparent, okay, to the incident radiation, right? It is virtually transparent to the incident radiation, and therefore the radiation can escape from those wavelengths, at those wavelengths. And this is what is illustrated here in this diagram. Okay, this diagram we illustrate the solar window, the atmospheric window, etc. Okay, so what do you see here in this diagram? On the x-axis is the wavelength. Okay, this is for the ultraviolet, visible, near infrared, far infrared. Okay, that is long wave and thermal radiation on the right side, and shorter wavelengths, very small shorter wavelengths on the left side, UV, visible, etc. And on the y-axis, what you see is the absorption. Okay, so in this diagram, we illustrate the absorption because of the different gases which are present in the atmosphere. For example, oxygen, ozone, water vapor, okay, carbon dioxide, etc., etc. And as you can see that now, these gases absorb differently at different wavelengths. Okay, the response of these gases are different at different wavelengths. Okay, for example, now in this wavelength from 0.3 to say 1 micron, the water vapor has the least absorption. Okay, this is the line of absorption. Okay, this dark line illustrates the absorption of the radiation. Okay, this dark line is indicating the absorption of radiation by different gases. Okay, and you can see that in this wavelength from 0.3 to 1, the absorption is minimum. Okay, and that's because of the water vapor. So this is the solar window. Okay, similarly, in this wavelength band, approximately, let's say about 8 micron to about 12 or 13 micron, the ozone has the less or least absorption. Okay, ozone has the least absorption. So this is the atmospheric window. We call the atmospheric window for the ozone, right? So now you know about what is opaque and what is transparent, right? Which wavelength is opaque to the atmosphere, which wavelength is transparent to the atmospheric radiation, right? And these things you should remember. Okay, now what is Doppler broadening? Okay, Doppler broadening is shifting of the frequency at which the gas molecules experience the incident radiation by virtue of their random motion, right, towards or away from the source of radiation. You have studied the Doppler effect, right, in your BSc physics? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Doppler effect?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is exactly the same. Doppler effect, as you know, must have studied that now. When a train is approaching you and is blowing the horn, you know, how the intensity of the horn will change as the train approaches, because the distance and the speed, right? And similar things happen also for all frequencies of radiation. Okay. And that's what we try to exploit or utilize in the Doppler radar. In the Doppler radar, weather radars, for example, what we try to measure the speed of the wind speed. Because as the wind is approaching you, right, its frequency of absorption, the pulse which is sent by the radar will change because of the speed, right? So the Doppler broadening is the shifting of the frequencies at which gas molecules experience the incident radiation by virtue of their random motion towards or away from the source of radiation. This is the Doppler broadening. Then we have got the pressure broadening also. There is another term called pressure broadening. And what is pressure broadening? Or Lorentz line shape, okay, or collision broadening. And this is due to the molecular collisions. Because of the collisions between the molecules, also there is a shifting of the frequency, okay, because of the collision of the molecules. That is called the pressure broadening. Okay, that is called the pressure broadening. All right. So you should remember this definition. What is pressure broadening and what is Doppler broadening? You can have some small multiple choice questions or short notes you have to write sometimes in the examination about the Doppler broadening and pressure broadening. Okay. In this diagram, we illustrate the comparison between the Doppler and the Lorentz lines. Okay. And again, here you see on the y-axis, you have got the k nu, right? We have Jobson at different frequencies, okay? And here, the blue line is indicating the Doppler broadening, okay? And the red line is indicating the Lorentz broadening, Lorentz line. So these are contrasting absorption line shapes associated with the Doppler broadening and pressure broadening. Now, what you see is this, in this diagram, area under this red curve or the blue curve are the same. The area under this red curve and the blue curve are the same. Okay. Whereas its absorption can be different, right? Depending upon the frequency or wavelength, right? So this is what is illustrated in this diagram. Okay, clear difference between Lorentz and Doppler broadening. All right. So I think today we shall stop here. Okay, and in the next class we shall talk about the radiative transfer processes. Okay, the radiative transfer processes, which are different for short wave and for the long wave. We shall discuss about that in the next class. And whatever you have studied so far, okay, in the radiation class, about all these absorption, scattering, re-emission, emissivity, and the laws of radiation, all those things will apply. Okay, when we are trying to calculate the transfer of radiation to the different layers of the atmosphere and the resultant heating or cooling of the layers of the atmosphere, all those things will be important. When we compute that, then these things will have to be considered or taken into account. Like, so will we stop for today? It's about 1:45, 1:46 now. Will we stop for today?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So do you have any question for today?
Sir, what is Lorentz lines?
Lorentz lines, we just discussed. Lorentz lines, we have just discussed because of the pressure broadening. Okay, pressure broadening, right? As we discussed, the Lorentz lines are because of the pressure broadening. And you can see in this diagram, we just now, is my screen still shared or not? Is my screen shared? Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We just explained, we discussed that this is because of the collision between the molecules, air molecules. The absorption or broadening of the frequency because of the collision between air molecules are also termed as Lorentz line or the line of absorption because of the collision between the air molecules are also called the Lorentz lines. Okay. And it's also called the collision broadening. horizon broadening or not horizon broadening. Is that okay?
Sir.
Who was that? Sri Lakshmi, is it? Who asked this question?
Sir, it's me, Sri Lakshmi, sir.
Okay, great, yeah. So, any other point? Any other question? Is that okay, all?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Good. So, read all these things and then in the next class for the radiative transfer, again, we shall refer to all these things, okay, at different times. All right. So, we stop now. I stop sharing the screen. Okay. And shall see you tomorrow. Okay. I stop recording also.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.